Hello, everyone. Welcome to tonight's Live with Bucky Live. It's Thursday at 5:30, so everyone is in the right spot. We're super excited to have you join us tonight. So thanks for making time for us. Tonight, we are very excited to bring you this session, which is specifically for students who are entering UW-Madison for fall 2021. So today we're actually going to talk about just generally the university housing experience and what you could expect possibly in your experience for fall. So we have a great panel of people I'm going to introduce here in just a moment, and we're actually going to be answering your questions live. So be sure that you drop them into the live comment section of this video. We see that some of you have already started doing that, so please keep them coming. We're going to go through as many as we can tonight. I also wanted to mention that if you would like to watch a replay of this live stream after it, or view any of our other Live with Bucky Live sessions, which are on a variety of tons of different topics, be sure to check out our Live with Bucky Live page, which you can see at go.wisc.edu/livewithbuckylive. Also, we are getting together every single Thursday at 5:30 to talk about a variety of different topics in housing. So if you wanna see what we're gonna be chatting about, be sure you check up the calendar on the same page to see what is upcoming on our sessions. So before we dive into questions here, we're just gonna start with some introductions. So let me start by introducing myself, and then I will also share who we have on our panel tonight. So hello everyone, my name is Sarah, and I work here in communications and marketing at University Housing. With that, I'm gonna pass it over to Susie.
Hello everyone, my name is Susie, and I'm a student housing ambassador here with UW Housing. I'm currently a junior studying marketing, and I'm originally from Brookfield, Wisconsin. And as a student housing ambassador, I work primarily with current and incoming students and their families to answer any questions via phones and emails, and also get to do some fun things like this live stream, as well as a virtual tour that you will see later on. So now I'm going to pass it on over to Patrick.
Hello, welcome. My name is Patrick. I am the Assistant Director of Operations for Dining and Culinary Services. I've been with Housing Dining for about 20 years now. Essentially, I oversee six operations. Most of our operations are a la carte dining halls. Next year, we will be implementing another all you care to eat dining location as well. We have one Starbucks on campus. Multiple coffee houses, along with smoothie shops, sandwich areas, three large convenience stores, and looking forward to this opportunity to answer any questions that you might have for us. With that, I will turn this over to Dylan from Res Life. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Good evening. My name is Dylan. I'm a Residence Life Coordinator here at UW-Madison within the Department of Residence Life. Basically, my position is a full-time oversight of a specific residence hall unit. So I provide support to house fellows, which are student staff that live in the communities, with residents who are living on campus, provide programming support, help troubleshoot roommate issues or other concerns regarding life in students' hall, or at least the ones that I'm helping oversee. And then also a point of contact if folks have questions or issues, but they're not sure who to outreach to on campus. Folks can outreach to me, and then I'm happy to get them connected with our campus partners who oversee different areas. And with that, I'm passing it back to Sarah.
Thanks a lot, Dylan. So as you can see, we've got a great group of people here. We've got your residence life experience, we've got dining, and then we've got Susie, who really kind of is an expert on everything and can really help with those roommate and assignment questions that we have coming in. So with that, I think I'm actually gonna kick it off tonight by bringing Susie back on here. So Susie, we're gonna start our session today with a question for you. And this is actually a really good question, and we get this kind of question frequently. So this question comes to us from Kay, and Kay is asking, what is allowed and or included in a dorm room? Is there a fridge? Is there a microwave? Is there a coffee maker? Can you share a little bit what is included in a room?
Sure. Yeah. So I'll start with what comes in the rooms. So each room comes with a bed, a mattress, a desk chair, a wardrobe, and then some sort of bookcase. And then in addition to those things, there are also mini fridges in each room, as well as things like window coverings, waste baskets, and cable TV and internet. And in terms of what you are allowed to bring, you are allowed to bring a microwave and any sort of coffee maker that doesn't have a hot plate. So any sort of like Keurig coffee maker, but we don't allow things with hot plates or open flames. So no candles or, you know, those coffee makers with hot plates or toasters. But again, encouraged to bring a microwave and you will become an expert at microwave cooking.
Thanks a lot, Susie. I know there is a website that has furnishings on it. And then there's also this really great list on there that's called What Would Bucky Bring? And that really gives us an opportunity for you to kind of see traditionally what we recommend people bring and what you, you know, might want to consider. So be sure you guys bookmark this page and check it out. It's super helpful with packing. And actually, I think I might ask Susie one more question here before we jump into our virtual video tour. So Susie, lots of questions coming in here. May 1st is looming on the horizon. So I'm wondering if maybe we can just maybe kick things off tonight too to help answer these questions. So this question comes to us from Noah, and they are asking, for choosing a roommate, does that decision have to be finalized by May 1st? When the housing form is due, or can you still pick a roommate and add that into a form at a later date? What is the significance of this May 1st date? What's due?
Sure, yes. So you do need to have your roommate preference in by May 1st as well. So it's May 1st at 11:55 p.m. Central Standard Time. And by then you need to have your advance payment in, sign your contract, rank your hall preferences, as well as enter any roommate preferences. And you can change those things up until May 1st, but after May 1st, there are no edits. So to circle back to the question, yes, the roommate decision has to be finalized by May 1st.
Thanks a lot, Susie. So just a reminder, May 1st date is super important. So make sure you guys mark that on your calendar. So with that, just a reminder, if you have a question, keep dropping them in, you guys. We're going to keep answering those as we go along today. If by any chance we just don't get an opportunity to get to your question, or you think of something after this live stream is done, don't worry. There's a really good way to get a hold of us. So please fill out our contact us form that you can find at go.wisc.edu/housing-contact. So with that, we're going to just jump into a real short virtual video tour of our residence halls in the Lakeshore. And it's actually starring two of our student ambassadors, Dexter, and our very own Susie, who's on the panel tonight. So with that, we're going to show this very short virtual video, and then we'll get all back to your questions.
My name is Susie, and I'm a student housing ambassador here on campus. I'm studying marketing, and I'm originally from Brookfield, Wisconsin.
And my name is Dexter, and I'm also a student housing ambassador here with UW-Madison. I'm studying economics and history, and I'm originally from West Hartford, Connecticut. Today, we'll be taking you on a tour of some of our residence halls here in the Lakeshore neighborhood, and we'll get to see it in the gorgeous winter weather. We'll also be offering you a glimpse at some of the services we offer here in housing. So come on, let's check it out.
UW-Madison residence halls house over 7,800 students, with over 6,800 being first-year students. UW-Madison has no on-campus living requirement for any of your years. However, over 90% of our first-year students choose to live with us, with some returning in years following. Students live in one of two neighborhoods, either the Lakeshore neighborhood that we're currently in or the Southeast neighborhood on the other side of campus. Both neighborhoods house roughly the same number of residents. The Lakeshore neighborhood has more buildings with smaller concentrations of residents, and it's located on the shores of Lake Mendota next to the Lakeshore Path, near Camp Randall Stadium, and other outdoor recreation opportunities.
The Southeast neighborhood is located near the Kohl Center, the Wisconsin State Capitol, and Bascom Hill. In total, UW-Madison has 21 residence halls, including 11 learning communities, 3 additional communities, and 5 dining locations.
Learning communities are residential spaces that bring together faculty, students, and staff around a specific focus. Here in Adams Hall is the International Learning Community. Adams is also home to 7 language immersion houses. Adams and neighboring Tripp Residence Hall have mostly single rooms, with some doubles and triples available as well. Additionally, Tripp is home to our transfer house, which allows transfer students to start building community right when they get on campus.
Common spaces, social lounges, and study dens like this one are located in every one of our residence halls. In addition, the Greenhouse Learning Community is located right here in Leopold Residence Hall. Looking for a job? Every year, over 2,000 students work with housing. Apply today at go.wisc.edu/student-jobs.
Laundry rooms, like this one in Leopold, are located inside or next to each residence hall. Residents can scan their WISC card, which is their official UW-Madison photo ID, to pay for washers, and dryers are free. Your WISC card is also used for things such as building access, dining, printing, and a few other things as well.
This is a resident room in Leopold. Rooms in newer halls like Leopold feature walk-in closets, higher ceilings, and controllable air conditioning and heat. Similar newer halls like Leopold include Og and Smith in Southeast and Dejope in Lakeshore. Each resident in a room is provided a mattress, loftable bed, desk, desk chair, bookcase, hutch or wardrobe, and dresser or built-in shelves.
Other resident rooms are more traditional, like this one in Cole. In addition to furniture, we also provide for each room compact refrigerators with two and triples and quads, window coverings, closets or wardrobes, mirrors, wastebaskets and recycling bins, streaming TV, and high-speed wireless access points in each room with wired Ethernet connections available.
This is the hall desk for Cole and Leopold, located in Holt Center. Your hall desk is where you can get your mail, pick up packages, check out supplies and equipment, resolve key and WISC card issues, get information on campus or local areas, and much more.
And here we have Dejope Residence Hall. Dejope is our only residence hall not named after a person.
Dejope is a Ho-Chunk word meaning four lakes, which is what the Ho-Chunk called this area because of the chain of four lakes nearby.
In many of our residence halls, Dejope included, we offer convenient locations for many different campus services, such as this University Health Services Satellite Clinic, classrooms, computer labs with printers, and group studying and tutoring spaces.
Cross-college advising offices like this one are also located within many halls. They offer help with choosing classes, majors, careers, and more. In addition, all our hall communities have a residence life office where live-in professional staff, trained in building community, and house fellows, our version of RAs, are available to answer your questions.
There's one large dining market like this one in each neighborhood with three smaller locations spaced throughout campus. All marketplaces offer a variety of healthy and delicious options and convenient hours of operation. Bean and Creamery coffee and ice cream shops and Flamingo Run convenience stores are available in some locations as well. Lastly, a Starbucks is available in Smith Residence Hall.
All new residents must select a dining plan tier for food purchases for the year. Purchases are a la carte, but residents must deposit a minimum amount of money into a resident food account on their WISC card. There are three tiers to choose from. All residents receive a 30% discount on prepared food and a 20% discount on prepackaged food. For those with dietary restrictions, nutrition and allergy info is posted in our dining locations and on our website. We also have a registered dietitian on our staff to work to accommodate all of your needs.
After you're admitted to UW-Madison, you receive an email from University Housing inviting you to log in to MyUW-Housing. From there, you'll be asked to enter your hall preferences. You must preference two learning communities and eight residence halls. Your assignment will then come out during the summer. For roommates, you can choose to either have a random roommate assigned to you, or you can list a preferred roommate. Many students use social media to find their roommate, but many students also find success in the random roommate process. In the summer, you'll attend student orientation, advising, and registration, and then you'll be all set to move in late August or early September. We'll be in contact via email the entire way, getting you important information and helping out by answering any questions you might have.
We're working with campus and local health officials to prepare for many additional scenarios as the COVID-19 pandemic continues. As of now, we anticipate returning primarily to in-person instruction for the fall 2021 semester, subject to change.
We're hopeful that the Live with Bucky experience will be more similar to a typical year next year, with some limited capacity in-person events available, but that, of course, is also subject to change.
No matter what our plans are, we'll make sure to communicate them with you via our website, social media, and email.
As always, please don't hesitate to reach out if you have any questions at all. Take care, stay safe,
and on Wisconsin. Wisconsin.
Well, we hope that virtual video tour was helpful. I know it's always great to look inside the halls, and especially as we're getting close to those preferences and your questions are coming, it's really great to kind of have that refresher. So with that, we've got lots of questions that have come in during that little video. So we're just gonna go ahead and dig right into those. So first question I have here is for Patrick. So Patrick, this question comes to us from Adam. Adam is asking, for dining plans, is there any advantage to choosing tier 2 or 3, or is it best to choose tier 1 and just add more money to it if needed? So actually, I'm gonna have you start out this question by kind of explaining how the dining tier plans work, and then maybe that'll help answer Adam's question. So we don't have a meal punch system here, like in some universities, right? You buy a number of meals, we have tier plans, right? Could you talk about that?
Yeah, correct. So most of our locations are a la carte. So we have three different plans. We have a minimum $1,500. We have a $2,000 plan and then a $2,900 plan, which is what we call our tier three. These are based kind of on what you think you would eat in a week. And we have a graph up there right now kind of showing that tier one would give you approximately 8 times coming through one of our dining facilities, right? Tier two, 11, tier three, 16. So it's kind of a preference based on how much you think you'll eat and how often you think that you'll be here. There is an incentive into tier three. That is that we offer fountain drinks out of our dining facilities for 1 penny. And then also a 20% discount on any of the prepackaged items. Yes, you can pick tier one and just add additional funds to that as you see fit. We have, sorry, I lost my train of thought. But so out of those three tiers, just kind of sitting down and deciding how often you think that you'll be eating with us, how frequent. These monies can also be used in our convenience stores. All plans come with a 30% discount for our prepared items. And then we offer a 10% discount for prepackaged items, which would primarily be items that would come out of one of our convenience stores.
Thanks a lot, Patrick. And I think too, the biggest thing to remember is, like Patrick mentioned, is it's a debit system. So it's a declining balance. So you're going to have a set aside amount of money that is just specifically for food. So you can use that at any of our dining markets. And then also, I do believe you could use your resident food plan in a couple other locations, right, Susie? Do you find this, as a student, what advice would you give if someone said, like, what tier plan should I do? I'm sure you get this probably a lot in your work.
Yeah. So as Patrick mentioned, you can definitely add more money. But I think a lot of students find, especially right when they move in, that maybe they wish they did have a little bit of a higher plan. And so those meals are estimated at about $5, those meals on that graph on the website. But $5 can actually get you quite a lot of food. For $5, you can get made to order stir fry, made to order subs, a bag of chips and a drink. So it is, you do get a pretty good value for your money. And then as Sarah mentioned, you can use that money that's on your WISC card dining account at other places around campus as well. So you can use that money at our unions and our Badger markets that are sprinkled throughout campus. And then lastly, that money does roll over semester to semester as well as year to year. So I wouldn't be necessarily scared of, going higher if you're deciding between them, but just kind of thinking about, how often you might go and how much you think you're going to eat.
Thanks, Susie. Really good advice on the meal plans. That can be a new thing to navigate and kind of hard to make that decision. So next, I'm going to bring Dylan in here. We've got some questions about kind of the best place to live. So Dylan, this question comes to us from the animator. So I like this question too. So the animator is asking, which dorm has the best quality of life? Clean bathrooms, spaciousness. So as you're talking about the residential experience, what would you kind of say is the best?
Yeah, I may be biased. I have worked in a few different buildings, but I would say working in housing that a lot of our buildings are pretty comparable, right? Like as Susie mentioned earlier, a lot of the same items are, in each of the rooms, a lot of them have the same amenities with bathrooms, common spaces, size of the room and things like that. Of course, there's gonna be variations. We do have some buildings that are more recently renovated and others, Witte just finished the building-wide renovation, not this year, but the year prior. And then we have some other buildings that are just a little bit newer. So there's different vibes there, but even in our buildings that are a little bit older that maybe not have been renovated recently, they still have a lot of the same stuff, maybe a little bit more charm and character to them than some of our newer kind of like renovated facilities, but you'll still have your common spaces in a lot of cases and a lot of the same things. I've walked through multiple buildings and I've never encountered a bathroom that I'd be like, oh, I would refuse to use that. So all those facilities are upkept and maintenance with our building specific facility staff. And if students recognize any issues as they are navigating through their semester or their year, they're always able to submit a maintenance request if there's anything that can be fixed throughout the year.
Thanks a lot, Dylan. And no matter where you live, you have access to those same resources that we offer, right? So you're going to have that ability, as Susie mentioned in our video, the CCAS, so the career advising, all of the events, all of those resources with support staff. So really, it's about what you make of the experience. All right, moving along here. We're getting lots of questions about this May 1st, so I just want to emphasize the May 1st date. So remember, this is the date when all of your preferences are due in My UW Housing. So that's going to include your roommate preferences, your hall preference, your application, and your advance payment. So Susie, I'm going to bring you back in here because this is kind of a question that pertains to that. So this comes to us from Mary, and Mary is asking, what if there are technical difficulties on the website on May 1st? Will there be staff to help with questions and problems since May 1st is a Saturday? So can you just maybe help, you know, reassure people a little bit what we can do?
Yes, most definitely. So yeah, it is a Saturday, but we will have people in the office on that Friday and that Monday. So definitely fill out our contact form on our website, as well as give us emails and phone calls if you do run into any issues. I also recommend that if you are sure that you're coming to the university, maybe start filling that out before the May 1st deadline to try to avoid any technical difficulties that, you know, might arise. That deadline is coming up, but we already have a lot of students that have gone through our system fully, so probably won't be on at May 1st. But my biggest recommendation to avoid those technical difficulties are if you can start getting everything done, you know, in the next couple of days as May 1st is coming.
Also, be reassured, everyone, if there are technical difficulties in our housing portal, we're aware of that, and we're going to do something to make sure that you guys are taken care of. So don't worry about that. We're here for you. So thanks a lot, Susie. So moving along here, I am actually going to bring Susie back here because we do have a student kind of preference question. So through the housing form, it says students can preference residence halls. How are individual rooms chosen? So can you clarify a little bit about how the assignment process works?
Sure. So as you said, so our incoming first year students can rank their preferences for these residence halls. And then from there, our computer goes in and assigns students into individual rooms within the residence halls. So incoming first year students cannot choose their own room. They can just preference those residence halls, and then our computer goes in and assigns the individual rooms. However, for students that choose to return to housing after their first year, you can pick your own room. So you can pick your exact room in the residence hall that you would like to live in. So that's definitely a perk of returning to housing after your first year. But your first year, all you can do is rank those preferences, and then the computer goes in and gives you your actual room assignment.
So really, if you're putting in your preferences, you should be prepared to either receive a hall on your preference list or off your preference list, right? And then that's how that works, right, Susie? Go ahead. What I was going to say, one other question we have that's a follow-up to this, and this comes to us from Dara. And Dara is asking, what time on May 1st is everything due again? Can you just share that time?
Yes, everything is due by 11:55 p.m. Central Standard Time.
All right. Thanks a lot, Susie. I'm actually going to jump over to have Dylan join us back here again. And Dylan, we kind of have, again, some questions kind of pertaining to what would be the right place for me to live. So we did get a question that is from, let me just find it right here. Where is it? Sorry. Kind of like, should I live in, if I'm living here, do I need to live by this hall? Like, what kind of questions do we have? We also have ones that are kind of along the signs of, like, I'm an engineering major. What hall should I live in? Here we go. This is from Carlin. Thank you. Carlin, if my major is in human ecology, does it matter if my residence hall is close to Nancy Nicholas Hall? What would you recommend?
Yes, I would say the short answer is no. It doesn't matter entirely. I think for folks who are coming in as new students too, Just keep in mind that sometimes you're taking classes that may be meeting different requirements, so they may be spread out, not necessarily confined to one building. But if you know where your classes are located and you can kind of see how that fits in with our layout of the different residence halls, feel free to keep that in mind. But we do have a ton of different options that make it convenient for folks to get around campus. We have the 80, which is a bus route that's free for students to use. So if your hall is by chance maybe a little bit farther away and you're not wanting to walk, or in the winter time when it's cold, you're able to use that bus route. There's a lot of stops throughout the different residence halls, so you don't have to walk too far to get to those different locations. There's a bunch of different bicycle paths. Madison is pretty bicycle friendly, so a lot of people opt to have their own individual bicycle. And then we also have some electronic bikes that folks can kind of use if they're wanting to do that. It is sort of like a faster and a little bit easier than a traditional bike to get around campus. And then obviously we still have a bunch of people who just opt to walk and things like that. So the short answer is no, it doesn't entirely matter. If it's something that is important to you and you kind of know where everything is going to be set up in terms of your class schedule and the specific buildings that you're going to be in, feel free to keep that in mind, but also keeping other things into consideration too. Like if being in a building that has a dining hall and it is important to you, then maybe you would be looking at Dejope or Waters or something like that. So I think those are important things to consider. I think I saw another one, and sorry if I'm going ahead of the questions, but about like specific majors or things like that. So unless you are interested in like a learning community that's kind of specified around an academic area of study, it doesn't necessarily matter. People are spread out all across campus in terms of the things that they're interested in studying. So if you're not interested in the learning community, or there isn't a learning community that aligns with your major, chances are you're going to run into someone who has a similar major or is in a similar class than you. And our house fellows, student staff, do a good job of helping new students communicate with one another to form study groups and things like that. So that way that support is in the hall too, but oftentimes people also find that through TAs or through their actual individual classes. So hopefully that answers some of those questions. If not, keep them coming.
Thanks a lot, Dylan. I'm going to bring Patrick back in here because we actually have a follow-up kind of to the dining question. And this question comes to us from Amy. Amy is asking, follow-up on the dining plans for tier one with 8 meals, what is considered a meal? And assuming you have one meal on Monday, assume you can still buy other food that is not considered a meal. So can you again kind of talk about how the a la carte system works? Because like I said, if you're touring campuses and you're kind of trying to compare, there are meal plans and dining plans, right? So I can understand the confusion.
Yeah, I think we're one of the few universities in the country that actually still operates a full a la carte declining balance style plan. So it's a little, I don't want to say complicated, but I think confusing. So we put 8 meals, 11 meals, and 16 meals next to those three tiers. And that's really to kind of give you an idea of how many meals that tier should offer you in a given week. So with declining balance, every time you enter one of our facilities, you'll be charged for each item that you take. So if you buy a soda, you'll be charged just for that soda. If you buy an apple, a bag of chips, and a sandwich, you'd be charged individually for the apple, the bag of chips, and the soda, and the sandwich, sorry. So as you come in as a often as you come in, every item you buy will tick away at that set amount that you have put in, or the tier that you've purchased. So when we put that 8 meals specified next to that tier one, that's really kind of an average that we've come up with that would allow you to eat that many meals based on that amount of money. But that really would depend how often you're eating with us, you know, the frequency, how many times a day, how many times a week, are you staying on the weekends? That's really going to what drives that money down at the end of the day.
Thanks, Patrick. I think that's super helpful. Remember, kind of use that as a gauge, but every student's eating habits are different. So you're going to kind of need to adjust that dependent on how that works. So I'm going to bring Susie back in here, see if we can help answer a couple more of these questions. So this question comes to us from Dara, and she is asking, as long as we complete the housing form by May 1st, do we still have an equal chance of getting the room of our preference regardless of the day we submit?
Yes. So as long as you submit your preferences by May 1st, that May 1st deadline, you have an equal chance as every other student of getting a preference higher, lower, or not on your list. It doesn't matter before May 1st. It doesn't matter if you did it, you know, the beginning of April, if you do it today, if you do it on May 1st, as long as you have everything in by 11:55 p.m. on May 1st, you have the same chance as every other student that has done the same.
Thanks a lot, Susie. And while I have you here, I'm going to have a follow-up question for you. So the other one we get a lot, this is coming to us from Ariel. Ariel is asking, when do we find out our hall and roommate assignment? So when is that coming out?
Sure. All of that information is coming out in about mid-July. So it's coming up quickly here.
Perfect. So let me see if we can sneak in a couple more questions here. So I think, let's see here. This would be actually a good question here for Dylan. So Dylan, why don't you pop back in here? So we have a question here from Adam. Adam is asking, are there TVs in the dorm rooms? If not, can I bring my own?
There are not TVs in the dorm room, so you are more than welcome to bring your own. Since that tends to be a little bit of a larger item, I would encourage you, whether you know who your roommate is going to be because you're preferencing each other, or once you figure out who your roommate is, to touch base, because if two folks are bringing TVs, especially if they're larger TVs, it can sometimes be a difficult setup to then get them to fit in a room and have it like make sense and be usable. So definitely be planning to bring your own and be in communication with your roommate once you know who that is. So that way you can plan accordingly for some of these bigger items.
Perfect. Good advice, Adam. I'm going to bring Patrick in here for actually a dietary and allergy question. So I think this is a great one for you. This question comes to us from Theol1999. Great name. If I have an allergy, can I submit an allergy requirement self-declaration form before knowing when my residence hall is? When should they be submitting kind of those self-declaration forms?
They certainly can get that started. What we would do is have you reach out to our dietitian, and she can provide you with all that information, not knowing specific as to what, you know, your allergy is. I wouldn't be able to answer that for you right now, but we do have a dietitian on staff, Agnes. She handles hundreds of these every year. The information's on there, but I would, as soon as you know you're coming in and where you're going to be staying, I definitely would reach out to her and we can get that process started for you.
Great advice, Patrick. The other thing is I know you guys have really great line signs throughout your residence halls that kind of allow you to help self-manage what that is. How does that work in the dining halls?
Yeah, so all of our items are labeled. You should be able to walk up and notice our signs. We label everything. We also have a program called Net Nutrition where you could dial down more specifically into an individual item, but all allergens should be flagged as you walk up. It should be the name of what we're selling, and all the allergens should be indicated on there. If there's ever a question or a sign is missing, you simply would just ask for one of our chefs or a manager, and anyone should be able to come out and assist you with exactly what you're looking for.
That's perfect. Thanks a lot, Patrick. I actually have a gluten allergy and navigating the halls with that has been a breeze. So they're really great at that. And Agnes is phenomenal. If you need something, she'll make sure you're taken care of. So we're going to squeeze in a couple more questions here. And again, just a reminder that May 1st deadline is when you need to have everything in. That's when your preferences are due. In my UW housing, this includes your roommate preference, your hall preference, your application, and advanced payment. So couple last questions here. This one's for Susie. Susie, this comes to us from Griffin. Griffin's asking, are learning communities selective? Can freshmen indicate they want to live in a learning community housing? So again, when you're going through your preferences, what are you asked to do, right? You have to preference two things and then preference one over the other, right?
Yes. So freshmen can indicate that they want to live in a learning community. And so if you go to our housing portal that you can access via our housing website, on the upper right-hand corner, it says My UW Housing. So if you go into that portal and you enter the part that asks for your preferences, you're actually required to preference at least 2 learning communities. So you're required to do at least 2 learning communities and then 6 residence halls. So the answer is yes. First-year students can and are encouraged to live in learning communities. And I definitely recommend checking out that section of our website as well to learn more about our learning communities.
Thanks a lot, Susie. I'm going to ask you one follow-up question here, and then I'm going to bring Patrick back in to kind of answer a halal food question here. So, Susie, question we get here from Catherine G. They are asking, can we change our roommate after our assignment if we find out that we want to room with something else? So that would be after the May 1st date.
Yep. So you cannot change that after the May 1st date. So very important that you get all of that in by the May 1st date. And if you can't find anyone and you're going random, that's definitely okay. Many of our students find a lot of success in that random process as well. But you cannot change the preference after May 1st.
Thanks a lot, Susie. So important. Everything needs to be locked in by May 1st. So thanks a lot. I'm going to bring Patrick back in here for one more question. This comes to us from 7 Amud 12, and they are asking, is there any halal food preferences? So do you accommodate a food halal dietary concern within the halls?
We do offer halal food options. We also have some kosher grab and go options available for the staff. The last 2 years, we've been offering halal meals during Ramadan, having the opportunity for individuals to place those orders ahead of time so that we could provide those options to the residents as well. But yes, we do offer halal food options inside all of our dining locations.
Thanks a lot, Patrick. So I know you guys still have questions coming in. We do have some staff that are going to stay on and answer those questions in the comment section. But unfortunately, we are out of time for tonight's live stream. Just a couple things I want to remind you as we're wrapping up our session. A recorded version of this live chat will be posted on our website afterwards. So to view that, go to go.wisc.edu/livewithbuckylive. I also noticed there's lots of questions on preferences and roommates. We did do 2 specific live streams earlier this month on those. So I would encourage you to go to that Live with Bucky Live page and check those out. A lot of these questions that you have there are covered directly right there. So that would be roommates, preferred or random, and preferencing your hall and signing your contract are going to be really great to go to reference guides for you. So just a reminder, if you do have a question though, send it to us through our contact us form at go.wisc.edu/housing-contact. Yes. And just remember that May 1st date, you guys, this is a date when your preferences are due in MyUW Housing. This includes your roommates, hall preference, application, and advance payment. So just want to bring all our panelists back in here and really thank you so much for joining us tonight. And we really look forward to welcome you all to campus in the fall. So thanks a lot and go Badgers.